Hey guys, it's Miss Jessica. We're here for another Grace Kids Online. You can see I'm in a new place again today. I'm still at home, and I know you guys are at home this week too. I know it's been kind of hard and a weird week with going to school and then getting told you have to go home from school and doing school at home. And so I am just praying that you guys are adapting well, that your moms and dads are able to adapt and help you. I know that this is so not normal, not what we're used to, but we just keep trusting that God has a plan and that He's watching out for us, that He's going to take care of us, and that we're going to learn some amazing new things about Him, about ourselves, about each other as we go through this really strange part of our time here. So let's go ahead and we're going to do some singing and dancing. Again, we're going to use our songs from sports camp this year. So get up. Get stretched out. I know right now it's, for me, I'm kind of stiff because I'm older than you guys. So get stretched out, get ready, and then have some fun singing and dancing, and I will see you back here in just a few minutes. All right.
If you walk on water, you can walk beside of me. If you heal the blind man, you can make me see. If you make the land to walk, if you calm the seas, I will follow you with all of me. Just singing, Jesus, Jesus, you saved my soul. You gave my heart new life. And now I know that when my life gets hard, I know just what to do.
Follow you, I will follow you, I will follow you. I am brave, cause I am yours. When I fall down, I'll get up. And all your love, I can't get enough. You are strong, you are Lord, and I am brave, cause I am yours.
Great music. I hope you guys had fun doing that. Now, we are going to talk about the next attribute of God. We've talked about several of his moral attributes. We talked about how God is good. He is just. He is righteous. And this week we're going to talk about God being merciful. Have you guys heard that word merciful, or maybe it's root word mercy? Do you know what it means? Think about it for a minute. Well, let's think about it this way. Have you ever done something that you knew you weren't supposed to do. Maybe when you were little, your mom gave you some crayons and something to draw on and said, only draw on the paper. I know I've told my kids that a lot of times. And then you just got a little carried away and maybe you ended up putting some new art on your walls. Or I had a cousin who used marker on the carpet. Have you guys ever done that? Or, you know, maybe for you bigger kids, your mom said, you can go play with your friends as long as you're home by a certain time, or as long as you don't cross the highway, or whatever the rule was to keep you safe and make sure you got home right. And you didn't follow the rules because your friends all wanted to go across the highway to go get snacks. And you knew you weren't supposed to go with them, but you did anyways. We've all done things like that. Now, think about your reaction. Were you glad that you disobeyed? Probably not. Did you try to maybe hide the fact that you disobeyed? Maybe trying to hide your drawing on the wall or hide your snack wrappers and tell your friends, don't say that we went anywhere, so that your mom wouldn't know you disobeyed? I know I've done that. I know I've tried to hide my sin before. Because we know that the consequences of sin are not pleasant. When we think about our sin here and our moms and dads and our teachers, we want to hide our sin from them because we know there will be consequences. We might not be allowed to go play with our friends if we have misused our mom's trust. Or our dad may say, you can't use crayons for a while if you draw on the walls. There's always consequences for our sin. And the biggest consequence of our sin is that it damages or hurts our relationship with God. You know, we talked about how God is righteous and perfect and how we are not righteous and perfect. And so that causes a separation between us. Think about, if you guys remember the story of Adam and Eve and the first time they sinned when they ate from the tree that God said, don't eat anything from this tree. What did they do? They hid in the garden thinking God couldn't find them. Now God could find them, but their relationship with God was never the same as it had been. And so we have this big problem that God is righteous, he's just, so he can't just let our sin go. But we also have a God who loves us, and he wants to have a good relationship with us, because that's what's best for us, is to be in relationship with him, and he knows that, and that's what he desires for us. So, what are we going to do? What's the solution? Well, God himself is the solution because he is merciful. When someone is merciful or shows mercy, it means they don't give you the consequence that you deserve. Now, with moms and dads, sometimes we can do this just because we feel merciful. You know, your mom could say, I'm really disappointed that you didn't obey me and you walked across the highway with your friends and went into that store when you knew you were supposed to stay at your friend's house. I don't feel like I can trust you, but I'm not going to ground you. I'm going to trust that you've learned a lesson from this and that you're going to do better next time. Or your dad might say, I'm really disappointed that you drew on the wall, but I think you know now that that was wrong, and so I'm going to trust you and let you keep using crayons to draw because I know how much you love crafts. So parents can do that because we don't have to be quite as just as God. But God can't not let sin be punished, right? Even though he is also merciful and wants to forgive our sins. So do you remember the solution we talked about last week? We had that piece of paper and we put the dots all over it. And we talked about how our sin are those dots, and something came and took away all the dots. Do you remember what it was? Yeah, it was Jesus. So when God's righteousness and justice allowed for Jesus to be the payment for our sins, his mercy is what actually sent Jesus to die for us. His mercy is what wanted us to be able to be forgiven, to be able to have our relationship with God restored. And so in mercy, he sent Jesus so that we wouldn't have to accept the consequences of our sin in that way. Now, our sin does still have consequences. You know, if you steal something and you get in big trouble for it and you have to pay it back, you still have to pay it back. You still have to pay for the thing you stole. Your parents might have other consequences for you, but your eternal consequences can be taken care of because of Jesus. Or if you tell a lie and people stop believing the things you say, that's a consequence of your sin. Now, God can still forgive you. He can still restore your relationship with him, but you might have to deal with some of the, we call them natural consequences, of your sin for a while. But God will be right there with you through it if you truly want to turn away from your sin, if you truly want to have a relationship with him. Listen to what the Bible says. This is in 1 John. It's a little tiny short book towards the end of the Bible. 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, that means if we admit that we did something wrong, he, God, is faithful and just. Faithful and just. He does what he promises and he does what is right. He will forgive our sins and purify us or clean us from all unrighteousness. So where God is righteous and we are not, he promises that he's going to clean that unrighteousness away if we will confess to him when we have made mistakes and when we have sinned. We don't want to hide our sin from God because really we can't. There's no way to hide from God because, as we know, he's omnipresent. He's always everywhere. And he's omniscient. He knows everything all the time forever. So we can't hide from him. We might as well tell him, "Oh, God, I'm so sorry. I messed up. Would you please forgive me?" And he promises that because he's merciful, he always will. He's never going to say, "You know, you've made that mistake 3 times this month. I think I'm done forgiving you." The good news is God will never do that. Now, does he want us to get better and better and stop making the same mistakes over and over? Sure, of course he does. And he wants to help us with that. He promises to work on our hearts. And he really does if we let him have control of our life. But he's never going to get tired of us. He's never going to get so frustrated with us that he says, "Nope, I'm done forgiving you. You've irritated me too much." I am so thankful for that. Because if I were God looking at me, I would get pretty fed up. I would say, "I gave her so many chances and she's still not perfect. What am I going to do?" But God doesn't do that. He's so merciful to us. And then that leads us to the last bit where we are supposed to imitate God, try to be like God in showing mercy. That is really hard because I am not naturally merciful the way God is. I want to have what's right, and I want people who have done things wrong to me to have to deal with their consequences. But God calls us to be merciful. He says, "Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as Christ and God forgave you." We have to be as kind as God. We have to forgive as much as God did. The Bible tells us over and over that because God forgave us, we have to forgive each other. Not we should, or it would be a good idea, or it's strongly recommended. Jesus says over and over, you must forgive other people. Now, that can get a little tricky, right? Because if we're forgiving somebody, that means they did something wrong. And when people do wrong things to us, it hurts us. So we hear the phrase forgive and forget. And a lot of times that's the best thing to do. If your brother irritated you today and made you mad, you forgive him and you just forget that he irritated you. You just move on with life. Those are the little kind of things that we just forgive and we forget. We don't hold them against other people. We just move on. With other things, it's a little trickier. You might have a bully at school, or you might have someone in your family who has hurt your feelings really bad. Not your little brother irritating you, but someone who maybe has said or done something really hurtful to you. And as you grow up, you'll come into those kind of things probably even more, because even grown-ups are unkind. So if you have somebody who's really hurt you, like a bully at school, either physically or just has really made you miserable and hurt your feelings and said all kinds of unkind things about you, because of mercy, you need to forgive them. The Bible doesn't say forgive them if you feel like it, forgive them if they're really, really sorry. It just says forgive them. So let's say you forgive your bully and you've said, okay, I am not going to demand that this person be punished. I am not going to ask God to do terrible things to them. I'm not going to hold any hate in my heart for them. But I still have to go to school with that person. Should I just let them keep hurting me? Well, no, you shouldn't. When you forgive somebody, it means that you stop being angry and hurt in your heart in a way that wants them to hurt too. But let's take this bully at school. They should have a consequence. They should not be allowed to keep bullying you. Hopefully, your parents, your teachers, your principal, the bully's parents can work together to get them to stop. But you know what? Sometimes people choose to sin no matter what someone else does. No matter how many times they get in trouble for it, no matter how many people ask them to stop or give them good reasons that they should stop, people choose to keep sinning. So now that you've forgiven this person who's been so unkind to you, and maybe they've even gotten a consequence, does that mean that then you hope that they're your best friend now? And you're going to just invite them to play every day and sit with them at lunch every day? Probably not, because you know that they're not a safe person. And so if they're not a safe person, you're smart to give yourself some distance from them. So when that bully is around, maybe you kind of go the other way and you avoid being around them. Doesn't mean you run away from them, but just you don't go up and put yourself right in their way. Or that person in your family who hurts you, who hurts your feelings. They say mean things to you. Wow. What do you do? Well, you can't stop being family with them. But maybe, you know, you don't tell them things that they're going to laugh at. Like, if your brother always laughs at you when you tell him how you did in school, or you show him your artwork, maybe you show your artwork to your sister instead of your brother, because you know your brother's not going to be kind about it. It's hard. Life is hard, guys. Things aren't always easy because we want to forgive people. And yet people are not always kind. And so we have to be smart. We have to not set ourselves up to continue to be picked on or bullied. We need to get help from grown-ups who can help us deal with those situations. We need to forgive the people who have hurt our feelings. But we also do have to be smart, and we don't have to forget that someone told lies about us or shared our secrets. We can say, that person always shares my secrets, even though I've asked them not to. I'm not going to tell them secrets anymore. You can forgive them and say, I'm not mad at them anymore, but I'm going to be smart and not tell them my secrets. You know, you just have to be kind in your heart and let go of wanting bad things to happen to people who have hurt you. That's what mercy and forgiveness are. And then you go on with your life. That's what forgiveness for you is about. It's about not being held back by wanting bad things for other people. About not being held back by being upset when they don't get in as much trouble as they deserve. Because what we know is that God is not only merciful, He's just. And in the end, people who continue to choose to disobey Him will have to deal with those consequences. And what we should want is for those people who are not kind, those people who pick on us, those people who tell our little secrets, what we want for them is not for them to get in trouble, is not for them to be punished and miserable, even though that's kind of what we want at first. What we should want is for them to find the same mercy and the same forgiveness that God has shown to us. So do you know what the best thing is? When someone has a problem with you and you have a problem with them, pray for them. It's hard at first. When you say, oh, dear God, my friend, or this person at school who should be my friend, has been really unkind this week. And I really want to be mad at them, but I know that you love them too, just as much as you love me. And I want to forgive them. God, help me to forgive them. please help them to want your forgiveness. Please help them to turn their hearts towards you. Oh, guys, if you can pray that, it'll change your heart, first of all. And if you keep praying for them, God is going to change their hearts, too. And they are going to find mercy and forgiveness and allow God in to start changing their hearts and changing their lives. And that's what we should want for everybody. Well, I hope you guys have made it through this crazy week at school. I hope next week goes a little more smoothly for everybody. Let's go ahead and finish our time together with some prayer, and then I have a quick announcement for you guys. Heavenly Father, thank you for being merciful. Thank you for showing us compassion even when we do not deserve it. Thank you for sending Jesus to die for our sins so that we could be forgiven, so that your mercy and your justice and righteousness could all be working at the same time. Please help us to be merciful. Help us to pray for people who make us sad or who hurt our feelings. Help us to have hearts that forgive. Lord, I pray that you would watch over these kids as they go back into school next week. Lord, that you would give their teachers and principals wisdom, that you would give their parents wisdom, that you would help everybody to work together well. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, I have one last thing to tell you guys. I hope that you can either be at church this Sunday if your family is coming to the service or watch the Grace Church service online this Sunday, because two of our Grace Church friends, our Grace Kids friends, are getting baptized this Sunday. Now, some of you already have been baptized and you know exactly what that means. Some of you may not know that word or not really understand it. When we get baptized, it's a person who has decided to follow Jesus, and they have somebody help them go down under some water and come back up as a symbol or a living picture of what happens when we trust in Jesus. You see, going down under the water is symbolic of Jesus dying and us and our sins dying with Jesus on the cross. And then when we come back up out of the water, that's just a symbol of being raised to new and eternal life with Jesus, just the way that Jesus rose from the dead. So when we get baptized, it doesn't wash away our sins. It doesn't take anything in our hearts and change it. That's already been done before we decide to be baptized. When we get baptized, it's just a way of us showing all our friends and our family and the rest of our church that we are serious about following Jesus, that we love him, that we love God, and we have been forgiven, that we don't want to live the old way of being constantly slaves to sin, but we want to be alive with Jesus. So I hope you'll get to watch on Sunday as two of our friends make that choice and give that declaration to all of us. All right, I hope you have a great weekend. I will see you guys later. Bye!